Hey, so thanks for coming down after lunch. I know, difficult time. So I'll be talking about Fedora Cloud. So a little bit about me. That's me flying. So cloud is something I'm doing for a long time, as you can see, maybe inside house. But other than that, again, a few lines. Like, I'm a Fedora ambassador and contributor, working with Fedora for a couple of years now, almost a decade. Working with Python project, officially working in Red Hat as Fedora Cloud Engineer. That means I'll be happy to take orders and requests from the rest of the community to do things for all of us. And we have most of our cloud guys here, a lot of people here, I can see. And if anyone is not familiar with the Fedora Cloud group here, anyone? Oh, we have three people at least. Cool. That's good. Otherwise, it would be too boring for all of them. I could have just skipped whole talk and go to the discussion part directly. So what I'm going to talk about is actually cloud working group. It's not about like just any particular product in general, but exactly what we do, how we do it, and how we can actually help us or try to do the similar things that we are working on. So which brings us the question, what we do, which is, next slide, a pretty old thing, we do cloud. It's too large. So which brings to the cloud base image. The kickout image which you can get if you go to getfedora.org and click on the rightmost cloud icon. So you will find that different kind of images you can download from the thing, and the cloud base image is basically a generic kickout image which you can use on OpenStack instances or any other local or private cloud if you are running. We also build the AWS AMIs from the cloud images we build. We have an application called FedImage, which is connected to the same workflow or the process. So whenever there is a new build of Fedora Cloud Image over Koji, this particular application actually takes that build, creates the AMI out of it, and publishes it over all the different regions available. So if you want, you can actually right now try out the latest nightly builds on AWS as a public AMI. So all those things are available. I'll be going into these smaller parts of the project later on, like in the discussion part, if anyone wants to talk about. So another thing we are working on is towards the container side, because yes, cloud and container is now going similar level of buzzwords, maybe. Maybe container is doing more now. But yeah, so we maintain something called Fedora Docker files. Anyone here? Do you know about this thing, Fedora Docker files? I'm not asking you. So Fedora Docker file is basically a GitHub repository which contains a lot of different kind of example Docker files. So these applications, let's say MySQL, let's say Apache, there are many things, including Firefox. So these Docker files are made and maintained by the community Fedora Cloud working group and the community, which you can use to start a base for any container you want to build of your own. Or if you want, you can actually try these images from the Docker registry. I think, Joe, you were mentioning about, you are also using one of the images, correct? From you or someone else? In the cockpit, you wanted to update something, correct? One of the Docker files?
There's a bunch of updates that need done,
make sure that we have yum to DNF issues, because almost all the Docker files were written before DNF was made default. So
we have
yum right now, which is becoming a problem.
Yeah, so that's another issue. Actually, I was talking something else. But anyway,
Steve McGallagher, maybe.
Yeah, not you, sorry. So the idea is that we have these Docker files as an example, it's not only the example which you can only see, but you can actually use those containers to do needful for yourself. And there are Fedora magazine posts also about the same Fedora Docker files if you search about it. It talks about, and obviously the wiki pages, where you can go and see how you can use these Docker files for something you want to build up. The another new thing came up in the during last release is the background images. Anyone here uses background? Okay, so many of you. So it used to be not any official Fedora image in background land, but now we are actually building two different kinds of images. One is targeting the LiveWord-based background, and the other one is obviously VirtualBox. So we have both the images up and ready for you to download and try out. And it's coming out from the same pipeline, so it's basically the same thing, the same kind of image built up in the same Fedora infrastructure, which you can use to having your own backend boxes on top of it. And in the other thing, the cloud working group also makes sure that Fedora, the operating system, and the latest cloud image is available in different public cloud infrastructure. So like Dusty worked with the DigitalOcean team, so make sure that the latest Fedora is available on DigitalOcean, so that when you create a instance there with Fedora, that actually is the same Fedora image which is coming from Fedora group. Same goes with Rackspace and AWS. And as I talked about AWS before, it's an automated process right now. So what happens when we say that we build a new cloud image? It's basically a Koji task. If you want to go to Koji task, there is a task called create image. So this is the Koji task or the build, which actually creates the images for us. And in the background, it uses something called Image Factory. Anyone played with Image Factory here? Okay. So at the beginning, I found there are enough documents about Image Factory, but I couldn't find much documents about how we use it to build our own cloud images. So one thing I'm actually trying, I don't know how good or bad it is, some people talked about it, is about whatever I learned from our work in the group, I try to put them up into this particular URL. It's a GitHub repository, open, it's Sphinx doc basically. So if you want to learn about what we are doing or how I built up the cloud image or how I do my testing and stuff, so you can actually go there and check it out.
I've heard from several people.
Oh.
Don't underestimate it.
Thanks.
From the imposter syndrome talk this morning.
Yeah, but I know at least one thing, that this is the only document available in internet which actually explains to you how to build up the image. I'm going to demo that. But yeah, so, and the other reason I was maintaining it was obviously because I keep learning and forgetting things. So if I just write it down here, whenever I forget something, I can just always go back to my own what notes and see, oh, how I did that 3 months ago. So anything now just goes in there. So it's the demo, yeah. So the idea is that it's the same thing. You can use the same tools and start building up your own images if you want to, if you want to play around, or if you want to see how we do that. So I'm going to go into the demo mode now and show you what we do. So the first thing comes up about building a cloud image is from where we build it. So we have a repo called spin-kickstarts. It's under Fedora hosted. So if you go to that project, you'll find that it contains various different kickstart files. And one of them is the cloud base. And you can find the other images, kickstart files, like the background kickstart files are also there. So that's the first place to start with. So I'm actually going to, you are being connected. Thank you.
Oh, if you're seeing that, you're on the wrong file. That's not the conference
network. I am in the conference network, I guess.
Yeah,
so by the way, this is the create image task which I was talking about a few minutes back. So you can see it built the Docker image also, the cloud, Fedora Cloud Atomic background image, and the base images are there, one of these. So one of the easiest way to start, even if you don't want to, you know, mess up with the spin kicks, the kickstart directly from the spins directory, what you can do is you can just go to one of these and yeah, let's say I'll go to this cloud-based rawhide. So this is the output. The primary output which we look for is this one, the kickout image. But this also contains the kickstart file it used to build this image. So that was my first point to start with. So you can actually see this particular kickstart file. So here is one point you should remember. So there are a few nightly builds which contains repository starting with infrastructure dot something, like fedoraproject.org and the URL. So please remember to replace the infrastructure with alt dot fedoraproject.org so that you can actually have the same repository, because it's not hid, something hidden, it's just that it's not available from outside the production network, which is infrastructure production network. So if you go to my the work notes, it actually contains all the packages which are required to be for you to install them. So first step would be just install the dependencies, and then after starting libvirt and things, desktop please work. No, anyone knows how to use this? I'm trying to move the terminal from here to that screen. It seems to be way too difficult. Can you please move? Seriously? Yeah, I'm trying to figure out how. Finally. Is the font size okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Huh?
No, that's okay. Oops. Okay, so it's getting cut. But yeah, so I actually have a small shell script file so that I don't have to type it every time. But basically, this is the command you were running: image factory -fn debug the base image, file parameter, install script, then the kickstart file, and our TDL -darkkitchenname.xml file. So you can actually download the same TDL -x6664 in our case .xml from the Koji task. It's there available. But please remember, if you see any URL pointing to infrastructure.fedoraproject.org, replace it with alt.fedoraproject.org. That part is important. And after this, so I can actually execute it like something like this. So I'm using a Fedora Cloud kickstart file which I downloaded before. So if it breaks, that means this might be one of the old ones. We were supposed to break. So maybe not so garbage text, you're stuck somewhere here where it's you're waiting for this 3-6, that is 10 minutes of, 10 minutes, correct? Yeah. No, 60 seconds.
An hour.
So it will wait for that, it's supposed to run till that time at max, But this is the only place, if you have any issue with your kickstart file, it will fail. And it will fail if within 5 minutes, that is within 300 seconds, if it cannot see any disk activity in installation, it will fail. So that's where I found that the people who actually tried this, they said, oh, I can see only this error, that no disk activity found in 300 seconds, task failed, and then you have lots of error messages. Not that useful. So my way of like debugging was to actually see what is going on right now on that thing. So I enable VNC in it, and I can connect to it. So just a second, reduce the size of this. So I have a tunnel, actually existing tunnel to the local box, so I use that. Oh, not this one. I think, yeah. There you go. So you can see the kickstart is an Anaconda working. So generally if it crashes, it also creates an image from the moment where it's supposed to, like, you know, capture the error messages. But in my experience, most of the time you'll find a complete black screen as the output, which is not that helpful. So I know that there is upstream work going on to have some kind of recording done, video recording of the whole installation, so that if required, we can actually see the screen session and like what's going on in the installation and where exactly it failed. But most of the time for me, just looking into this screen was helpful enough.
If you do the install in console mode with her and do everything non-interactively, you can just do get serial output as well.
So yeah, but this is not me doing it, it's the image factory.
No. All right, and it's.
Yeah, I agree. I would prefer that as well.
So, what is image factory giving you over, say, Word install?
What extra?
Yeah.
This way? I don't have to do that.
Yeah, I've honestly used Word install to do the exact same thing before, because you can just use the tree. So it doesn't do a whole lot extra. It actually has further capabilities that we're not using. It can do some of the like Word assist prep stuff as part of it. But it can basically, you can also output a lot of different image formats in the end, and also in inventory if there are panels that end up installed in the image. The main reason we're using it is because there was already work on making a Koji plugin for it, and then rather than inventing a new thing, we wanted to use the thing that existed. So doing an image factor in your own system mimics what we do with Koji, so you have a similar environment.
It's kind of like using mock to build a mock.
Yeah, similar. And the other thing it does actually, after the end of the installation, when the installation is done, it will try to remount the whole image and check things inside, and it will actually try to connect. So if you see the way when we build the Docker image actually gets built up in the same way, and there you actually pass a separate parameter where you mount it as a file system in the Docker in the Docker build. So that's the only difference between the cloud image building and Docker image building when you type the command from as a user's point of view.
Supposed to be a plugin for Image Factory and Koji, or an enhancement to it, so that it will actually make a little MPEG movie of the entire installation as it goes.
Yeah, that's what I said.
That's
the work is going on.
But like, what's the benefit of actually doing a movie versus having the console output and then saving like have you ever done script? Script with
console
script
output. I don't know. Ended up being very confusing to me. It doesn't have.
Scared somewhat.
Yeah, I'm not sure,
okay.
But there just wasn't.
I just think for
some of the places it was getting stuck, and from our early debugging for this, like the console output didn't have enough, and the QA view, we were like, I think Anaconda wasn't quite designed with that in mind. It's more.
Okay. Do you know what the policy is on keeping those videos?
We don't have
it.
We don't have it yet.
It'd be big, right?
Yeah.
So that's why I was thinking,
yeah.
changing the kickstart to say command line, and Dennis kept putting it back to be the GUI, so I don't know.
So one thing I found was like, because right now the only thing it's doing is the screenshot, correct? In all the image build files I saw, only one screenshot actually contained the error message, and rest of them all black screen. Like, if nothing else, if not the text, then I'd love to have the, at least the video.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I was just wondering, you know, why video versus text plus time to get information.
Text would really be better.
Searchable, right? You don't have to watch the whole video.
And it's something which I can download from India. Nothing else from me. Like, video, no. Never happened.
Talk to Ian about this.
Okay.
Seems like a useful thing to look at least for as image back.
So yeah, so you can actually build up the Fedora Docker image also using the same way. And my workload contains the other piece of the missing command which you can do. But so the final output of this command is actually a raw file which you'll be leaving in your varlib some uid.raw file. So then what it actually does is it uses, I think, QMU image command, ing, to create, convert the raw file into a QCopy image, and you can play around with that. So if you want to make, you want to submit any kind of patches to the kickstart files for Fedora Cloud, so I would request you to actually, you know, at least do one local build in your place and see that image works or not. Yeah, but anyway, because none of us can actually do a real build except release engineering. So that's anyway one point.
So what you're saying is we need scratch builds for images.
That's something we're asking for a long time.
You see, yeah, part of the problem is in order to do any image builds at all with Koji, the permissions are not fine grained, so you basically have to be Koji root in order to build.
Like still together?
Yeah, so they didn't want to give that out. So I think that the cup image is actually for a while but always being built with scratch builds because of some other issue. But I think that's fixed now or could or should be. But it was kind of a, that's an implementation detail really. So you still had to be admin to do them, scratch or not.
Yeah, so we can't do scratch builds in that way because this particular task doesn't have that thing. Like, you have to be admin.
So, okay, so that is a Koji fix.
Yeah, so talking about Koji fix, we actually have an open ticket on our Fedora side, I mean, cloud side, and also on the Koji, is that the latest Koji, which is in, not latest, the deployed Koji in production, it actually creates a QCOW 3 image rather than QCOW 2, and kind of, so it's a version 3 of QCOW 2. So the problem with that is that our default, the QCOW 2 images which we built on the system from Koji, one cannot download, just simply download and upload it to any old boxes like running cloud running on Rel 6 or something.
I promise someone we fixed that for this release, by the way.
Can we fix the file names? QCOW3 and whatnot.
So anything requires a Koji patch, and the biggest problem is not, I think, writing about the patch, but the place where I can test the patch. And I did that only once in my lifetime, installing Koji, and I don't want to do that again, ever. So.
Aww.
And another thing I see is that when it reboots the image after installation, the cloud in it, it actually waits for a long time to get the metadata. And sometimes it just fails for that, and if I just restart the build again, I mean, if I do a fresh build again, it just works. I think it's some kind of rest condition which, like, where cloud wind gets stuck and then image factory things. I think you can see now, it's the 300 thing is going down.
Yeah, quite this time on this finding is now.
So, oh, okay, yeah, you win.
So is booting the image that I just built?
Yes.
that's actually what happens with Bert install when you do this, and that's actually not what you want, because you don't want to bring it up and have FileNet run, because that's what you want to do to have happen when the people bring it up in the cloud.
So one of the things which I do in this particular case is actually pass the command line argument for what I do for the Docker also, so that it doesn't boot it up. But that's more of a hack rather than having the actual solution in place. So I think I can just reconnect again. Yeah, so here you go. Stuck there.
You're not in
cloud. I was doing that.
So every time I see this, and then I start hoping, like, can Cloud Dennis please finish before your factory says that?
Yeah.
Yeah. This build is broken, unusable.
What are you using for metadata?
Nothing.
At all.
That's why.
But you've got a thing that provides it, right?
Huh?
You have a metadata provider thing. Like the test cloud does metadata.
Oh, test, what test cloud does is it creates a seed.img and just adds as a link drive.
It's a little bit.
Yeah. Well, it's using a config drive. Okay.
Yeah. The other thing I'm trying to write up, so that will have a metadata service which you can just plug it in to the link. I'm working on a separate one. So.
My question for that is one of the mistakes I made was just download the cloud image, especially if like, you get 4K sets. If you don't show it to download the raw image, and I try to boot it in the Rip Manager. Oh, I can't log in because it's freaking blocking it.
Yep. So the only solution to that is that you create a text file with the information, then create an image file out of it, and there is a page which explains actually step by step.
Yeah.
Or the other option is, as I said in the morning talk, is Test Cloud.
Yep, that's right. Yes.
Yeah, so just,
yeah.
Do you have any fist on Test Cloud? It's in copper, by the way, right now.
I'm in the same room as Roshi, so
oh.
I know about it. I tested it before I came here, even so.
Oh, okay, so cool. So, yeah, I use Test Cloud for all the local things whenever.
I was thinking the web page needs to be updated and make it clear that you can't just use the raw image with any.
Yeah, so that's the whole idea about cloud image, right? So like anything you cannot just start using it.
Yeah.
So
this was twice to talk to web page people about that.
Right.
Yeah, so this worked. So now this is where I pray. Like, you know, 40, 30. So I still don't know if it will pass or fail.
This suspense is terrible. I hope it'll last.
I think it'll fail. 10.
We have betting odds. Are you taking a fall?
Last 10 seconds.
Yeah, it's not.
It's booted, but it thinks somehow it's not booted.
Yeah.
Time out. Yay. So, yeah. So, these days actually many times when I see this, I try again once more. If it doesn't work, I just pass it that inf parameter true, right? So.
Kushal?
Yeah.
Backseat drive, but the description of this talk said we were going to discuss the working group and how to get involved, and I think maybe some folks in the room would like that.
Yeah, so talk description. So one of the point is that I was not supposed to be the speaker for this talk, so the description.
We were.
No.
We
don't know. Yeah, so I'll talk about that part also. The talk description was actually came from Odd Socks, David Gay. So, yeah. So he submitted this talk. He asked me, like, can I go ahead and submit? I said, okay, I'll not talk about it then. But because he's not here right now, so I'm giving the talk.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so.
He's gone, gone now, right?
Yeah, so this is actually the starting part to actually one side, but then how can I help? So that's, I think you were asking for this. That was just the next slide. So.
I get impatient, I'm sorry.
No use. So, docs. I know we have a lot of wiki pages, but we need really updated information because cloud and containers are something which is getting updated like hourly maybe. So we need more blog posts, more user docs which will focus, may not, it doesn't have to be, you know, it should show everything about everyone, but maybe it's just documents which can show how to do one particular thing, maybe using the cloud images or say using the Fedora Docker image. Fedora Docker files, maybe that's another place, like the same Docker files. So if you can use it, or if you are using it in some of your project, you may want to talk about, I mean, write down like how you are using it, so that anyone else, if they have the similar kind of problem, they can start using it. And as I mentioned, that we do not have many documents explaining like how things work. So you may think that everyone knows about those stuff, but if you still write about those things, it will be helpful. Just to give you an idea how docs think, so we are working on another Fedora 23 or 24 change is about systemd networkd to have it inside the cloud image. And for the first few days, it was really difficult to find out any information on how to actually use it properly. But it got really good documentation, but just not from Fedora's point of view. Like I was thinking if I'm the only person who's experimenting. But then Major Hayden, who gave our keynote, he has some really good blog post explaining how that thing works.
Yeah.
So then it becomes like almost a single configuration file with two lines or four lines. Two actual lines and two nodes. So that's it. It's the easiest configuration I ever saw for configuring network. But yeah, so any kind of documentation help is actually going to help us. And obviously the next big thing is quality assurance, which is actually doing the testing of the stuff. So as I said that Koji, there is an automated way of nightly builds. So if you want, you can actually test the nightly builds on your system, or if you have a, say, OpenStack or Eucalyptus, or I mean, you have account to AWS. So ours, the same nightly builds also go to AWS as nightly AMIs, so you can boot them up. And as I said about the networkd image, so I have a public image in, I think, two zones only right now, which if you want, I think in, in Singapore and
US West.
US West 1. So, I don't know where it is, but US West 1. So you can actually play around with those images also, so they will boot up with networkd inside AWS. And we do have a test wiki page. So if you go to the, just search for Fedora Cloud test wiki. So you will go to the wiki page where we have the kind of test which we run right now. And
what do we test?
What do we test? So maybe
all of it.
All the things?
All of these.
So the first thing I can see is your attribute testing.
Say what? Yeah.
We
got another one of those coming up soon.
Yeah.
So
the day I'm flying in.
Right now, the test matrices that we have are not as comprehensive as they should be.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, testing things like making sure you can reboot, making sure that you can log in, or add packages, or.
So these are the few tests which are like must pass for right now. So base startup, system logging is working, services, disable, enable, reboot in between, SE Linux would be enforcing, and the last one is that's the service manipulation. So this one was, there should not be any services failed on the system, this particular test, if you go into it. So I have a project which I talked about in the morning to Neil, which basically helps you to, you know, if you don't have a cloud, you can just install DNS install to Neil and use to Neil to boot any of the local the cloud images and do any kind of testing. So that will be complete automation for the whole thing. Otherwise, this means you have to manually log SSH and type the commands.
What's the distinction between Kuner and Test Cloud?
So Test Cloud is the way to use the cloud images on your system.
Okay.
So Test Cloud will bring up instances as VMs,
okay,
where you can SSH log in and just use it as a normal VM, but from the cloud image. Tunir is an automated way to basically either boot up from a cloud image, number one, or it can do any remote system, like using SSH. It will automatically execute a series of commands and give you the output, like whether they passed or failed. So all these tests, I have a GitHub repository. I'll just open it, show it here.
One thing, none of the test cases we have right now do anything that couldn't be done better by automation. Like, it basically, we require a human to log in and do some cloud tests that a computer could do better than we could.
Yeah, so.
So we should have more test cases, but there's probably 100 different things I can think of that we should add as more automated tests before we add more human test cases.
I seem to recall that coming up.
So this is where
a while ago, somebody suggested using Passage on,
that was me. Yeah.
So this is where I actually. This is where I actually converted those human tests into simple Python unit test cases. So I use this in Tunir. So as you can see, let's say test logging or the SE Linux. So this is basically because I'm a lazy guy and Python programmer, so I really don't want to type these things for myself. And it automatically tests those things, and we really want to add as many things as possible. So I'm already added something which I test in all cloud images, if it's not atomic, is this one. Is I actually install DNS install a package and make sure that the package got installed. And the same thing goes to the atomic, like, you know, the Docker should work. If Docker doesn't work on atomic, it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, we can do a lot of tests for cloud init stuff as well.
Yes.
Never. Cloud init server is especially fun because that's something we have to test on every cloud.
Yeah.
So what I need is actually using some way to, if we can, you know, spin up those instances in different clouds. So as of, I can talk about only Tunir because it's working for me. The Tunir can actually use just SSH. Doesn't matter whether it's a background image or a cloud image on AWS or Express or anywhere, or your local cloud, and actually do the test. So following the same rule, for Fedora 23, one of the major changes is a two-week atomic. And there we are, I hope it's okay. So there we are working on something called Auto Cloud, which is basically automatically testing the cloud and the atomic images. And if I'm on the VPN, I hope it will, it's okay to go ahead, right? No? Oh.
All right, could you off my picture for that if you want? That's on the feature page.
Yeah, so.
Two-week
atomic.
I also have some statistics from my talk yesterday morning that are more specific to cloud stuff that we could show if you want. I can still a couple slides.
Yeah. Here you go.
That's super big.
Wow. And how to go this side?
Click on view image.
Huh?
Click on it and say view image. There.
Yeah.
I think it was just trying to point out that building tests are really important.
Yeah, right.
Sure.
So that's the scheme that people are working on. I drew that scheme and then threw it at people and said, make this happen. So, yeah.
So me and a couple of other Fedora contributors are working on this particular part. So where we are using Tunir, actually, so basically listen for the fake message that create image is done, download the image, boot it up, test it, and then release the information based on that. So, if I can just only get.
The idea is we'll have these every 2 weeks, have a page somewhere for our atomic page that has the latest
the completely work in progress, by the way. So, and as I was saying, that took week before we had an online hangout on air demo, and by mistake I ran it against the production data instead of test data, but it worked exactly. It's supposed to work in production. So I was so happy. I was like, whoa! So these were the three cloud images, task, OG task IDs. So it says success, and if I go to the output, you'll see what all tests actually it ran and things. So these are actually the Python unit test cases which I wrote, converting the our normal test cases. So everything worked perfectly, which is good for a demo.
Autoclone is just like a front end for your needs.
So there are a couple of glue scripts which is actually listening for fed message, used to need to boot test and save the data in a database. And Autoclone is just that whole glue. And with a flask, dashboard in front. So it will fire up the message based on that.
Do you have it on
your
GitHub?
Yeah, so it's on my GitHub.
It's on your
GitHub? Yeah. Right now. But I'm mostly managing it, not writing much of code for this, so I'm getting lots of good Fedora contributors who are working on it full time. So
excellent.
From the community side, so that's pretty good.
Can you go to matjam.org/temp? There's a couple of images there, and literally a couple of images. Click on the second one. So this is the editions slide I showed there. You can see it better here. The two spikes on the right are the purple spikes, basically. That's the workstation Fedora 21 and 22 release. And so you can see below, the red line is the cloud, Fedora Cloud. You can see that going to the new Get Fedora site really increased the visibility of that because it was that little red line. So on the previous release, Fedora 20, where it went from nothing to something, that's when we had at least a cloud download page. Before that, you had to go hunt for it. So having a cloud download page made it go up a little bit, and then bumping up to Get Fedora made it a visible line rather than just hugging the bottom. But we don't have a strong upward trajectory, which I would kind of, in an ideal world, like to see. And we don't have much of an increase from 21 to 22. It's still fairly flat right down at the bottom. Of course, we can't, with our current system, count EC2 at all. So who knows?
These are image downloads.
These are image downloads. So it has very little meaning on, like, did they launch a million or did they download it and be like, what's a cloud?
It's going to be even more distorted than the ISO.
Yeah, it's super hard to understand what this means.
Right? You were talking about install counting during yesterday morning, right?
Yeah.
Maybe that will give us some metadata.
Yeah, and so one thing that we're sneakily doing, every other cloud image in existence that's popular, Ubuntu and Amazon Linux, whatever, when you log into it, it shows you a message of the day with number of pending security updates. That also has the incidental thing of causing those images to hit the update server so we can count them. So that will give us more than nothing that we have now.
So if you're logging into the server.
Yeah, but they run it in the background to refresh. And so right now, I have the strong suspicion that a lot of the images are booted up and never touch updates. So how do we get in?
I mean, as a system, I've been installing young cloud on all my EL server machines. Find off or some start tasks to check for updates would be great.
Right, yeah, so that it should be doing that.
And one of the other things which is in the pipeline is that updated cloud images. So we, as I said in the morning, the first talk, we already have one ticket open with the release engineering for an updated image, and hopefully we'll be able to do at least once every month updated cloud images, which will be released. So, but that is progress. So if you want to test those images, because we tested it, we need more people to test and verify that it actually works well.
So if you switch to the other, and this is still downloads, but this is shows just the atomic and cloud-based ones there. So the green line is the cloud-based. Actually, we actually do see it a little bit. It's the same increase here as before. And atomic, this last release, is way up from zero to something. So that's pretty cool. And on the topic in general, and of marketing Fedora as a cloud image, Josh
I would like to see us moving towards making the Atomic thing the main offering of Fedora Cloud. I think we still need the, this is Fedora that runs in the cloud, cloud-based image, so that's useful for a lot of different things. But I'd like to move that off to the side and make the Atomic. Because I think there's an interesting story around Atomic, and I've really had a hard time telling people why they should use Fedora Cloud, other than, you know, Fedora is awesome, and here's a cloud version of it, and that's not a very good hook to people who don't know what Fedora is already. It's great for people who already are into Fedora and know why what's great about Fedora, but it's not a very good sell, whereas Atomic has an exciting story about containers and the new operating system.
My only point would be, you know, add enough message on that page or wherever that, you know, you can still, it's not like that we stopped making the base image. This is how you can download it. So,
yeah.
Because there, like, most of those users will be still looking for the updated cloud images. That would be my point.
We may have a very good book now, which is when you come to the
Fedora, we won't see.
I'd like to go for registering these official images with Vagrant tools and Docker tools. So when I base an image off of Fedora, I'm getting the official one.
So the Docker, I know that if you do, what do you call it, Docker pull Fedora, so that comes the official basic Docker image from here. So it's just that the process is manual right now because it's mostly things are in the Docker side are not that good for automation. So it's still a manual, one person does it. It's Adam right now. Huh?
We don't have a way to probably store security credentials.
So our basic problem with putting cloud images and services is that we are not prepared for it from a legal point of view. Most of our stuff about redistributing it to Fedora on the legal page is focused on this idea of
I want to redistribute it.
And we say, yes, sure, you can. But all the stuff for cloud.
Thank you, by the way.
You must sign up for our stuff to accept the liability.
Sorry, it's just the discussion part.
That's fine.
So
I need to stop it.
Microsoft makes us do it. That's why we're not